Hello everyone, welcome to my presentation on practical pathways to net zero carbon buildings. And in this particular slot, I'm going to be talking about how we use data and performance-based outcomes to drive low carbon designs and low energy buildings. In the first instance, we're tasked with three main priorities that are climate, biodiversity, and well-being. And obviously the buildings that we design, operate, and sort of operate in have a huge impact on each one of those. And as we've seen quite recently, some pretty disastrous impacts on the climate, flooding, fire, droughts, etc. So it's a really key aspect of our design and our responsibility to drive low energy, zero carbon buildings. And to sort of emphasize that, some key facts around sea level rises, plant species loss, you know, loss of coral reefs globally. That is, you know, quite a devastating impact on the planet that carbon emissions have. So what is net zero carbon and how do we get there? This graphic represents whole carbon for the building, which includes operational, embodied, and that end of use life, which is the whole picture of carbon emissions in the building. And five quite simple steps to get there, really. You know, assess that baseline, understand what our energy and carbon profile is, how we optimize and upgrade that. You know, how do we reduce energy, improve our systems and our performance in reality? And also generation on site. How do we reduce our impact by our own generation? Also including sourcing of energy. Where do we get that energy from? Is it renewable? Does it rely on fossil fuels, et cetera? And the final piece of that is how we offset our carbon emissions through offsets such as afforestation, peatland restoration, offset payments, or, you know, maybe some different generation scheme. And also I think a major output of that is verifying our net zero carbon aspect, publishing our data, letting others learn from that data and how we influence others to get to net zero carbon too. But in this instance, really kind of focusing on the points one and two, assessing that energy and carbon baseline and how we go to reduce those, that energy consumption and those carbon emissions in our buildings. What we have here is an example of operational and embodied carbon. This is a study across a number of different office developments in the UK. And what we've mapped here is the operational energy consumption of each of these offices. And also an example of a recent office development where we're trying to consider embodied carbon. And you can actually see from that data, there's quite a wide spread of energy intensity usage. And actually, if we map on there, the REBA UK GBC LETI targets for a zero carbon office at 55 kilowatt hours, actually there's quite a lot of work to be done across the industry in order to get to those targets. But really my sort of feeling around this is, how do we ever get to those targets? You know, not every building has this level of data. It's not open access. We can't all easily grab this. And even still, you know, the bar charts show whole energy consumption, but that doesn't necessarily break that down into different end uses such as computers, hot water, heating, ventilation. So in order to drive more efficient design, we kind of need that granularity of data. And then that data can be fed back into our designs and obviously influence and improve. And likewise with the embodied carbon agenda, it's kind of gone unnoticed a little bit here in the UK. Everything's sort of focused on regulated energy and carbon, you know, driven from regulations and various environmental assessment methods. Whereas now there's a wider focus on embodied carbon and it's starting to be taken more seriously. But again, there's very little data out there that suggests how buildings have performed, how they are performing, and how we improve those and get better. And I quite like this quote from The Economist that actually, you know, our most precious resource is no longer oil, but actually data. Now, how are we going to use that data to better improve not only our existing building stock, but new buildings coming online? And how do we evolve our designs if we don't have that data and understand how they're operating? And this is an example really of, you know, where we use data day in, day out. So, you know, the majority of people nowadays wear smartwatches. Most people have smartphones. These all track our health, activity, data such as walking, running, breathing, mindfulness, everything that's sort of recorded just straight from our pockets. And likewise, even in our homes and our offices, you start to see some of these kind of sensors in the middle here popping up that monitor constantly temperature, noise, lights, pollution, air quality, so many different metrics that come from these small sensors. And even likewise in our cars, there's a live feedback of how we're performing in the car. You know, if we're short on fuel, we drive a little bit more economically, and we try and extend the range just by sort of making those micro adjustments to, you know, how heavy you accelerate, how heavy you brake, etc. And this is data that we're accessing every day in our own lives, and we make immediate changes to make better improvements. Whereas we come to our buildings, and often this is what we're kind of met with. There is no data, it's missing. BMS systems went down. There's a missing chunk of time. We don't know what happened. So what do we really know happened in that building? How do we know how that's performing? How do we make that better? It's really quite tricky to take that and feed it. So there does need to be a bit of a change in the way we address our data and the way we meter our buildings. The introduction of Neighbours UK will definitely create change. You have to monitor, verify, and publish that data. And that can actually be used and fed back into our designs and make better decisions earlier on, whether that's architecture, services systems, control strategies, etc. And what I have here is some examples of where we have had good data and sort of granular data to understand what we've done in our design work. So what these charts are effectively showing here is half an hourly heat demand and peak heating demand. And what this data effectively showed us was that from the installed capacity of the heating system, it was only really ever sort of getting towards 200 kilowatts at peaks, but then breaking that down into, you know, annual hours across the assessed period. You know, we was very rarely kind of going above 200 kilowatts. We're spending most of the majority of time between 60 and 90 kilowatts, really. And that we kind of took that data forwards, and what we could realize is that, you know, although systems have been sized to meet various standards, actually we could reduce those sizes and not compromise environment and actually reduce our energy and impact. And this is where we applied some of that data as some examples here. So the three charts on the left show design estimates through simulation modeling and then the actual energy consumption. And the hospital example is quite extreme, almost 35 to 40% more energy consumption. And if you look at the gas data, that's you know, almost three times as high. And likewise, in the school example, the sort of the gas heating was much, much higher than the simulation estimate. And actually the PV and biomass contribution was zero in the end. What we actually found out as part of the post-occupancy process was that they were never installed or commissioned correctly, so never operating. And likewise in the dwelling, quite a small gap, but there's still a gap there nonetheless. Just signifying again the importance to use data and understand what we've got going on. And then where we had data, and we fed that into design and had some post-occupancy and aftercare processes in place, you can actually see that the energy consumption either sort of matched the estimations through design, or in the case of the office and the university teaching space, had a reduction in the energy consumption. And that was really down to sizing the systems, understanding how they operate, and feeding that back into the design at the very early stages and getting all the stakeholders on board, letting them understand why decisions had been made and for what reason. So in terms of using that energy, I quite like this circular approach to data usage and improving our building design. So really, you know, getting that data feed or good data from buildings and feeding that into design. Early engagement with the design team, understanding and working to agreed outcomes. suggesting that actually we meet energy consumption targets rather than carbon targets solely. And the design starts to mature around those targets. So not only just engineering systems, but architecture begins to evolve so that it enables low carbon design and even getting stakeholders on board. So, you know, office tenants and owners and developers can really understand why we are making certain design decisions and why, using good quality data in the background to provide the evidence that actually we're still going to meet environmental targets. You're not going to have any sort of impacts on your condition internally. And they begin to understand, and they can feed that into their other developments as well that they may be working with on other consultant teams. And that really starts to drive that sort of holistic approach across the built sector rather than just individual projects. And as I mentioned, with the Neighbours scheme coming into play in the UK, publishing and recycling that data will become more and more open and evident. You know, we'll have greater access to these pools of data, but it would be more encouraging if every development had open source data that was published and everybody could gather that data and understand why and how that building is using energy, in what seasons, and how that data could then improve other developments. And feeding that in and having that circular approach would really help reduce the performance gap in buildings and actually create more practical pathways to net zero carbon, rather than just sort of incorporating technology that we think may work and actually doesn't necessarily work in reality. We can use all of this data to actually make more informed decisions to get to that low energy building that we all desire. Thank you.